that I personally am extraordinarily enthusiastic about, because it is an encyclopedic, comprehensive understanding about why white people act and behave in the way that they do. Something that seems is slipping away from us as an objective to get through this life in the ways that our enslaved African forefather parents understood. They did not have the formal knowledge gained through public schooling or higher education, but they knew to get through the day, to get through the week, to get through this life, to survive these people, they had to have an understanding of some sort about why they act, why the white man acts and behave in the way that they do. We have been socialized to perceive that we're equal, that that was an important goal to achieve. Reading this book, hopefully you'll be saved from that illusion. I don't believe that you can defeat an enemy or find your liberation without a thorough understanding of your oppressor. You cannot recapture your African mind if you do not know the worldview, the philosophy, and explanation for the behavior of your oppressor. A sister said to me tonight, one of the Africans in this world we live in now, one of the problems that Africans have is that we do not understand the difference between ourselves and the Eastern and the Western white man. The Eastern and the Western white man. I believe that the answer to many of these questions are thoroughly explained, thoroughly documented, thoroughly referenced in this book, Yurugu. Having studied as thoroughly as possible, and I believe studying isolated and singularly by yourself is not enough. That's why, one of the reasons why I'm a member of this organization. But what bit of knowledge I've gained, I see this as being one of the classic works that has been put together, like that of Sheikh Diop and Chancellor Williams and so forth and so on. You know the people. This is, for me, the book of the year, maybe the book of the decade. Therefore, it gives me great pleasure, great honor, to bring to you this humble sister, this queen, this scholarly warrior, Sister Dr. Marimba Ani. Put your hands together.
Begin with libation, which we didn't do yet. Okay, so Brother Richard is going to do that.
What we will ask you to do in pouring this libation is for each one of you to call an ancestor, one known to you and one known to us all, and that will invoke the ancestors with us. Nan Williams.
Delphine Douglas Richards. Nananda. John G. Jackson.
Marcus Garvey.
Yeah, Asante Wa. Maurice Bishop. Harriet Tubman.
Frederick Douglass.
Walter Riley.
Nanny.
Malcolm X. Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Stephen Hotel.
Let our words, sound, vibrations be heard by them, and let them be a font of now to receive the message that the sister Ani presides.
Madasi, Madasi. Hotel, everyone. Alafia, Wahom to say, Habari Ghani. We greet each other in the languages of our ancestors. We begin to use the languages of our ancestors, and that begins to shape our consciousness as it was meant to be. You can't hear the, you can't hear me speak. The drums are interfering with you hearing me speak. I say Madasi to the chapter study group of ASCAC for having me here. Madasi is thank you in tree language of the Akan people, now mostly in Ghana, also in Togo, Asante Sana, and Kiswahili. And I say Madasi to all of you who have come here this evening. It's wonderful to see you. We have an after-school program in Harlem. This is our 12th year. It's called the African Heritage After-School Program. And one of the very first youngsters to be in the program is here this evening, my daughter, Karimu. I call her my daughter. Karima, would you stand up? Very, very proud of these young people. The very first place that we met was in a little store called Harlem Graphic Arts. It was on 125th Street, and you had to walk upstairs to get to it. Much smaller than the room that we're in now. Not really even half this size because it was very narrow. If you could picture that, maybe a quarter of the size of this room. And it was owned and run by Brother Amos Wilson. And we needed space, and he allowed us to be there. We would come there on Tuesdays and Fridays for 2 hours each, and we would put up a curtain, and we would sit behind the curtain with the youngsters. They were between the ages of 6 and 10. Karimu remembers all of this. While people would come in to buy books and to do copying and so forth in the front part. This is one of my memories of Brother Amos. So we were close, we worked closely together. He and I, before that, had gone to graduate school together at the New School for Social Research. Amos was, above all, a critical thinker. And I think that was the power of who he was, intensely so. So it is very appropriate that we should be talking about critical thinking, as Brother Richard has said tonight. This Sunday at 4 p.m. on 125th Street in the heart of Harlem at the Victoria Theater, there will be a celebration of Amos, his spirit, and the work that he has given us. So anybody who wants to just take the drive up to New York, just be there, and the community will be there. That's the Victoria Theater. It's in the same block as the Apollo, 125th Street, at 4 p.m. And I do believe that some people are planning to go, so you might want to talk to people after today. One of the things, we call the spirits of the ancestors because we believe that they are a part of our community, that we are not whole unless they are with us, and that we need their energy to make us strong and to keep us focused. So when we pour libation, it's real. It is not just a matter of honoring people and calling their names for that purpose, but it is also calling forth their energy. And we need to understand these kinds of concepts more. We need to get more deeply into who we are. And as Brother Richard said, the African worldview. One of the things that we also believe is that the African life is a process of transformation. We go through a series of transitions in our life. Brother Amos is now beginning a transition, and that his spirit needs our spirit to help him make the transition. So if you can be aware of that, and as we have these celebrations, these ceremonies, that's what we're doing. We're helping that process to take place as it should take place. So understand that you need to participate in that. You need to meditate on that. You need to pour libation for his spirit daily. In fact, you should be pouring libation daily anyway. And we can talk more about that at another time. Now, I want to take you on a journey this evening. It will take a while. I hope that you have the patience and the seriousness to come with me on that journey. I think that you do. It's wonderful to see your faces and to feel your spirit. So trust me and come with me. Critical analysis is what we're talking about, as well as critical thinking. I'm going to focus on analysis. You cannot effectively analyze anything critically without having a frame of reference. You must begin with a frame of reference, come from a frame of reference. It's where you're coming from. It is your foundation. It's what allows you to think. It is a context, and it is only within the context that things become meaningful. And it is a context which allows you to focus your thought. For us, the African worldview centers us in the African paradigm that is model for thinking. The African paradigm model is a basis for conceptualization. By that word, we simply mean how we think about thought, what we think truth is, what we think reasoning is. So that all critique, all analysis, proceeds from a conceptual framework. And we now, as African people, need to consciously construct our own conceptual framework. We have been using a Eurocentric conceptual framework without understanding that that's what we have been doing. That brings us then to the reality, the concept of culture, how important culture is. Culture is a context for us. It is where life takes on meaning. It is what gives us order in our lives. It is what unifies us. It is what identifies us, that is, gives us a sense of identity, tells us who we are, what it is that we should be doing. If we were centered in our culture, we would understand that we were at war, that we are at war. But without being centered in our culture, we don't understand that, so we don't know how to behave. We don't know that we need to identify the enemy who has already identified us as victim. So that culture directs our collective behavior and commits us, gives our lives commitment, a sense of commitment, gives us nia, gives us purpose. And it is therefore political. Culture is political. Culture is not something you do aside, something you do in museums. It's not peripheral. It is not tangential. It is the center. Culture is political and it is ideological. Every group of people that are part of a culture are also part of and share a worldview. And that worldview is the way in which they relate to and define reality, the way they understand the universe and the definitions of reality with which they work and that they use. So the two concepts of culture and worldview are very important. It is how culture relates to thought, and that is very much a part of what it is that we will be talking about this evening. So we want to move then to, just briefly, what is the nature of the African worldview? Why are we doing this? Because we must center ourselves if we are to engage in critical analysis. Where are we going to center ourselves? In the African worldview. In the African worldview, we conceive of the universe as a spiritual whole, as a unified spiritual whole. And it is spirit which connects things, which joins things. It is a connecting force. We understand that as African people. We, as African people, are affirmed by the natural order, and we indeed affirm the natural order. And the natural order is the basis of a maotic order. A maotic order, which you know as truth, justice, righteousness, harmony, right order, balance, maat. Our universe, we understand to be spiritually based. It is life-giving and life-receiving. And so the principle of reciprocity is very important for us. The power that we get through connectedness. That's very, very important. Because what we're going to be doing is contrasting this worldview with the European mindset, with what is called the Utamawazo in the book, Yurugu. The symbolic forms allow us as African people to reach to the depths of truth, layers of truth. The universe is multidimensional. It is not limited to the outer, to the surface, to the superficial for African people, for the African mind. We must think deeply. We seek to attain harmonious development And having been affirmed by nature, all we have to do is to be in tune with ourselves, with our African selves, and we will be in tune with the universe. Life, again, is a process of personal transformation, where we move towards and from the universal life force, the source. And so these are some of the aspects of the African worldview where the lineal is enveloped within the cyclical and the spiral, so that our sacred concepts are non-lineal concepts. We transcend the lineal. The self for us is a communal self and a cosmic self. It is not an isolated ego. And we are accountable. We are accountable to Ma'at. And we know things through the rhythm. Through the rhythm of understanding, the rhythm of feeling, the rhythm which joins, the rhythm of the drum. And metaphor, symbol, becomes the statement of the deepest truth. It is said by the Dogon people that in the beginning, Ama, the creative principle, created the first beings, the primordial beings, according to the sacred and divine principle of complementarity, giving every one of those beings a male and a female soul, so that every primordial being had twin souls. But in this process of creation, there was one of these primordial beings who, in his arrogance, aborted himself from the process of gestation, and so took himself away before he was complete, before indeed he had a female twin soul. And he sought to create an earth which was more perfect than that which Ama could create. But as he began to do his work, he realized that the beings which he created were deficient, were incomplete, as he was deficient and incomplete, so that he was unable indeed to create a world in order or in a state of harmony. Realizing this, he returned to Ama, seeking his female twin soul. But Ama had given that soul away. According to some versions of this story, Ama then used that female twin soul in unison with a male soul to perfect Earth. But that soul was no longer accessible to this being. And so he was destined to search eternally for the wholeness, the completion, which could never be his. That being is Yurugu. On reading that, I knew that the title of this book had to be Yurugu. And I was moved, we were moved, to create the conceptual framework that involved the Asili, the concept of the Asili, the cultural seed. And this conceptual framework allows us to unmask Yurugu, to see Yurugu for what he really is, to understand how he works, and more importantly, how he affects us. That is what we need to be about now. So the analysis which we came up with, the Asili analysis, I call it, helps us to see consistency, helps us to see pattern in European behavior. It tells us about the logic of the culture, how the culture works, and it helps us to ask the right questions. The Asili approach or analysis in this way becomes a grounding presence, a centering concept, helps us to understand how Yurugu is different from us. The Asili concept is the key to explain their behavior. And it allows us at the same time to be comprehensive. It always provides a context within which we place European behavior, European institutions, so that we can understand them. The Asili concept allows us to particularize Europe. That is very important, because what they have done is to present themselves to us as being universal. So we're not sure when we're looking at them and when we're looking at ourselves and when we're looking at something which is true for all people. We must learn to recognize them specifically for what they are. We must learn to be able to see their expressions of nationalism. We must be able to recognize their statements of political interest, which they couch in terms of objectivity. We must learn to be able to identify expressions of their ideology, which are their commitments, not ours. So that the Asili concept then is both analysis, in that it enables us to understand various aspects of the culture, and it is synthesis, in that it allows us to bring it all together and to understand it as a whole. The approach then to this study is ideological in focus. It is political. We are at war. It reveals the monolithic or singleness, the monolithic nature of the culture. And we look more specifically at how they have used a concept of truth to promote their own culture and their own nationalism. And then told us that they were being universal. Defined this truth that they created, this so-called truth, in universalistic terms, a phony universalism. Said that it was non-cultural, non-political, or apolitical. And so, again, the concept of objectivity, one of the most pernicious, dangerous, effective concepts that the European came up with. And so what we're going to do now is to move through this analysis. We're going to see how it is possible to analyze the manufacturing of European power, to understand the mechanisms of European world domination. How does it work? Why is it successful? And then ultimately, we need to look at the spiritual implications of this system. And it's the implications of us internalizing it for our consciousness. The European cultural construct is based on a concept of truth, which implies European power over African people. That is what we will argue. Their energy comes from destruction, and it becomes destructive, and it is destruction. They are the destroyers, as Aikwe Arma would tell us. Get and read the book 2000 Seasons. Their culture is a culture based on death without rebirth. They are the desert which knows no giving. The system of domination is successful because everything in the culture works for one single purpose, and that is the achievement of European power. Everything in the culture is focused on the achievement of that power. Everything is for that purpose. It is single-purposed. And power here is defined as power over other. That's very important. That is critical. Power over other. And we have to ask the question, what is truth? For each culture, each people, each race defines truth and the method for reaching that truth. We can have a definition of truth which is spiritual and which is joining. It is possible also to have a definition of truth which is materialistic and separating. They achieve different purposes, and they are for different purposes. The European definition of truth has no spirit, no rhythm. It is conceived in the denial of spirit, and they have no concept of ma'at. They have defined truth in the image of who they are, and who is Yurugu. What did we say about Yurugu? Incomplete, the incomplete being. As they define truth in their image, then they become the truth. They become the smartest. They become the most intelligent of beings. You see how it works. But here you have a truth that lacks spirit, has no connectedness, no relatedness. You can treat everything, can regard everything as dead, lifeless matter, as the object. The concept of the object is extremely important in understanding European thought and how that thought sets the world up for their power. The object is that which can be manipulated, that which can be controlled. It is a thing. So we're going to look at the relationship between culture and thought. We're going to demonstrate how this Asili analysis works. We're going to understand how Europeans have, through their thought system, restructured reality, restructured the world in their image, an image which is spiritually deficient. Now, if they define truth in terms of a negation of spirit, and we are a spiritual people, then what does that do to us? We will understand European thought as it supports European imperialistic behavior. And so with that, let's get started with the work that we have to do this evening. First slide, please. You turned it. Okay. What had to happen was that we had to create our own conceptual model. Would it make sense for us to say that we were critiquing Europe and use the concepts that Europe had given us? No, it would not make sense. And for us to really free our minds, emancipate ourselves from mental slavery, as Bob Marley has told us to do, we must create our own models of thought. We must reconceptualize. So here we have a conceptual model based in an African feeling for reality, using metaphorically the symbol of the seed as origin, as essence. Here, the seed is understood to be the logos, or that which explains everything in the culture, the Asili. It is that which helps us to make sense of their reality. That which explains how everything in the culture fits. So this is going to enable us to look at European culture from our frame of reference, in our terms. The Asili is, in a sense, the DNA of culture. It is the template, the model. It is the matrix, okay, within which the various aspects of the culture take shape. This Asili, this cultural seed, once having been planted, if you will, seeks to fulfill itself and will do that through the various forms of the culture as they are developed. Remember that it is the ideological core. So it allows us then to take an aspect of culture and to see what is its ideological significance. Not anything objective, universal, but how is it expressing the will of Europe or of any particular culture that we are talking about? You can see the meaning of the term. The Utama Rojo, then, is one of the ways in which the Asili manifests itself. It is the energy that keeps the culture going. It is affective, having to do with motivation. It is the will, you can see that, the vital principle. It is the Asili as energy. The Utamawazo, culturally structured thought, is the way that the members of the culture have to think if the Asili is going to be fulfilled. If the Asili is going to fulfill itself, then the members of the culture must think in this way. That's the Utamawazo. It is important that as we reconceptualize, that we learn to use African languages, African concepts in African terms. Using those terms will help us begin to rethink, begin to return to our centers. Next slide, please. And now what we do is that we take the conceptual framework and we apply it to Europe. In other words, now it becomes specific. And so we seek to identify, well, what is the nature of the European Asili? What have we already said about Yurugu?
Incomplete
being, deficient. So Yurugu then must seek to compensate for that deficiency. Cannot do it spiritually because they're lacking in spirit, right? So they do it in an attempt to experience control, power over other. The term there, entropic, I took it from a concept in physics, which talks about energy that cannot be used for work. Energy, it's an energy process that moves towards disorder. At any rate, I said I would use it. And so that we can understand their Asili functioning from an energy that feeds on disorder, okay? Feeds on destruction. You have the incompleteness, the disharmony, a disconnectedness, you see, a chronic disconnectedness from the forces which would give a different kind of energy, okay? And then we move then to the Utamarojo. This is an Utamarojo, an energy that feeds off of tension, off of conflict. They can't know harmony. You understand that? Cannot experience feeling of harmony. It is unbalanced, always in a state of imbalance. At the same time, well, let's move to the Utamawazo on the right-hand side. This is the cognitive, the thought, how the Asili manifests itself as thought. Remember, there is no interrelationship. There is no cosmic view. A cosmic view of reality gives you interrelationship and interdependence. So what they have is always separation and disconnectedness. Knowledge in this system becomes an act of aggression. That is, it's power over the object. Now, if that's the case, then you've got to have an object to have power over. And that means that you've got to have separation. So everything in their system of thought is based on separation. Where does that separation begin? It begins in the self. They split the self. They
dichotomize themselves, separate themselves, as though reason and emotion were separate. And we even find ourselves talking like that, but that's not true. The African conception tells us there is a whole person, so these things are part of each other. They have to visualize it as being separate. Okay, so first you make the separation, you make the splits, then you make them what we call hierarchical, or you put it like this, where one is better than the other. One is superior, the other is inferior. Then the logic of this system says that the superior one should have power over the inferior one. Okay, the one that you value should control the one that is devalued. That's the key. Once we understand that process, you can understand everything that they do, everything that they say, and everything that they write and think and so forth. All the so-called philosophies that people try to say are different, they come from that culture. They're all the same in this regard. So that the thinking is confrontational. We go back to African worldview, we have complementary pairs. As Ama created people with the female principle and the male principle working together. So the societies then have the female and the male working together cooperatively. That's got to be our model. This model says no. Gotta be separation and confrontation. It says fanatically rationalistic. What does that mean? Rationalism here is not reason. Rationalism is the imposition of the control onto the universe, the imposition of the mental order of the European onto the universe. It's saying that things were created for you, by you. You become God where you are the European, and that they were created in the way that you think about them. So it is not a way of thinking where you try to become in tune with the universe. It is one where you impose your own mental order on the universe. That is what rationalism is. But you see, there is this need for control, and the need for control comes from the deficiency in the being, the deficiency in the acele. Okay? Since knowledge is an act of power, then it is necessary to have something that you're having power over. What is that? That is the object. The object becomes the most important thing for them, creating this object. What is the object? We said before, it is a dead thing. Something which is disconnected, something you're remote from, you have no emotional involvement with. That's the object. For them, that is all that you can know, is the object, this dead thing. This thing which disconnects you from the rhythm of the universe. The object is that which disconnects you from the senses. If you look in the dictionary, look up the word object and see, you'll see some very interesting things there. The object breaks the rhythm. It is the rhythm that the European cannot deal with. And so what they have to do is to reconstruct things so that they have the illusion that, well, I don't have to deal with that. That's okay, and I can know truth. So they redefine truth. I think we're ready to, no, let's hold it. Another implication of this is that there is in this system no symbolic sense. You see, symbols are what takes us to deeper levels of reality. But the European conception is a limited consciousness. It stays at one level. The literal level, the superficial level. According to the Dogon, this was called the level of jiri-so, word at face value. But then for the Dogon people, for African people, you have Beniso, word from the side. That's another level. You have Boloso, word from behind. That's seeing through, penetrating. That's another level. And then you have Sodai, which is the clear word. And that's a deeper level still. And for the Dogon people, you move, you see, through this process, getting deeper and deeper. Until then, you are finally prepared to begin studying and learning and receiving sacred knowledge, which is the knowledge of creation and how beings in the creation interact with each other and the purpose of human existence. The purpose of human existence. Question which all of European science has never been able to deal with and doesn't even consider to be an important issue. So that without this symbolic sense, without this connectedness, they are unable to move beyond the level of Jiri So. Okay? And now, let us go to the next slide. These charts are in the book for people who have them, have the book with them. At the beginning of the book, this is the first chart. Now, this one is dealing with what I would call the process of objectification. Objectification is what they do to the universe, this restructuring to make it into their image, to make it something that they can control. So let's see what happens here. And by the way, a good background for understanding a lot of this is Let the Circle Be Unbroken. Some of you, you know what it is I'm talking about. It's a small book. You can hold that up. But in that, I'm dealing with the African worldview. That, this is the book, and it was on sale back there before. I don't know if it's still there. Because, you know, we always begin with the African worldview. That's your key. That'll help you. That's the foundation. Okay? Now, let's begin. The universe we know is a cosmos. We know that it is spiritual. We know that, okay? But what they do is to take out spirit in their heads. They say there's no such thing as spirit. And that helps us then in this process of creating the object or of objectification or objectifying the universe. They begin with what they say is the thinking being and take away the idea of spirit. And they say they end up with the knower. And the brother's absolutely right. Descartes says, je pense, donc je suis, ergo, cogito, ergo sum, I think, therefore I am. That's what that's all about. And that's how they identify the human being, minus all the other stuff that's supposed to be there. Reality, they take out of context. You see, it's context which is meaningful. And they end up with a fact. Now, that's what they tell you in school. They say the facts, that's the most important thing. But for them, for the European, that's all that they can know. They say that's the highest. Yet a fact is something that has absolutely no meaning until you put it into a context. Think about that. Yet they want us to identify this thing called a fact with truth. Our truth is much too deep for that. That would leave us at the level of Jiri So. It's simplistic level, it's a reductionist level that they function on, but that gives them the illusion of control, of power. So then we have phenomena, or the way the universe presents itself to us through experience. You disconnect that, you see, again, from the universe, from a meaningful context, and you end up with this object that is created. In that process, then, according to them, you are able to then be capable of pure rational thought. And it is the thinking being then becomes the European controlled ego. Now, in that box underneath where it says European controlled ego, I guess people in the back can't see these slides at all. That's really unfortunate. If you have your books, try to follow along. But the European controlled ego, the idea is that they are able to control their emotional being. So then we get into that. Like, that's what, you know, you're too emotional. Don't be emotional, right? They say that they can detach themselves from the senses. So this ego detaches itself from the senses. In denial of spirit, which that ego fears, they are afraid of spirit. They then say that they can dominate the object, the objectified other. They can dominate nature. They can dominate us. This is an illusion that is created. But the entire culture is about how that illusion works for them. The box that goes further down says how this is fulfilled through the propagation, the affirmation, the perpetuation of this concept of objective truth, which we fall for, we go running after. This objective truth. And that is actually based on a denial of spiritual reality. It is predicated on self-alienation, separation from the self. It is, in fact, a method of control, which the Asili needs. It implies the devaluation of the African self. It implies the devaluation of the African source of knowledge, which indeed is spirit. And it is a concept of truth which justifies African enslavement and African exploitation. And that is basically what is being argued in the book, Yurugu. And it is very important to understand the role of the academy, that is so-called institutions of higher learning, in this process of the justification of European behavior. So that the process of objectification that we're looking at here is the process through which the object is created, because it doesn't exist, they create it, okay? And that process and the concept is sustained by the academy. This is a closed system, a system which is self-perpetuating. If you feel your spirit and you listen to your spirit, you will be able to totally repudiate this system. But we have to regain confidence, trust, faith in who we are as African people. Now, what happens is that this Asili is being fulfilled, it's seeking to be fulfilled in a historical process through cultural development. And one of the things that's very necessary is a national consciousness, that is, the development of a European national consciousness. And at different periods in their development, there There were different institutions which kind of come to the foreground. All of them have the same purpose, but there are different ones that are focused at different times. Okay, one of the first, the way I see it, is the academy, as Plato defined it, that helped to create a model for the emerging European national consciousness, because that wouldn't come to totally be until a later period. But this was setting things in place. But then there are other institutions. At another point, the church becomes one of the main institutions within which that national consciousness is developed. Then you have industrial capitalist order, which becomes that. You have scientism as they define it, which becomes that. Now you have this world order that they're talking about in terms of the European community. What is it? The European something community.
Economic
community. EEC, that's it. What we have to understand is how all of these are expressions of the European acele, the same cultural seed. Let's go to the next slide, please. And so now we will move to what was a very important institution in the development of this. Plato had started the ball rolling in terms of making epistemology, or concepts of truth, making that ideological, which is what he did. Now, we would have a statement which would take religion, so-called, and make that ideological. Let me back up a minute. What Plato was able to achieve was to take a way of defining truth and reaching truth and say, this is the only way, okay? Anybody else who doesn't do it this way is stupid. And because they're stupid, they should be controlled. That's what it says. Now we'll have a statement which says, this is the only way to approach, to reach, to relate to whatever you call God. And anybody who doesn't do that can be destroyed, enslaved, and so forth. So we look at Christianity as a core mechanism of the European acele for the achievement of European world domination. If you look in the middle, you see the circles, the acele always in the center. We see at the bottom there this word proselytization. What does that mean? That's about missionizing. That's about taking your ideas and forcing them on other people. That's about a posture that says, you people didn't have any spiritual concepts before we came here, so we are doing you a favor by giving you these. That is a statement of cultural imperialism. And it goes hand in hand with political aggression. It is an aggressive statement. So the Christian approach, posture, was the perfect mechanism for the expansion of European culture in this way, for the perpetration of European imperialism. And Constantine seems to have been the first person to have recognized what a perfect instrument it would be. You have your one God, so you have your one emperor, your one empire, which really represents one group of people dominating everybody else. So the Romans could take this throughout the world, they said. God had told them to do that. And they could bestow these blessings on the people that they would conquer. So if we look on the lower right-hand corner, you see that this institutionalization of this religious statement in Christianism allowed for the expansion of the European cultural self. We have never understood the significance of the European statement of monotheism. The Acili analysis allows us to do that. Why? Because we always see it in ideological terms. You must always ask yourself, how does it fulfill the Acili? What does the Acili do? It seeks European power. So monotheism for them really is about the control of one group of people. It is a model which says, if we can convince people that there is only one true God and we got him, then they gotta come to us for that. And in the process, we can enslave them. That's what the monotheistic ideal means in European terms. But we have not understood that. We have not understood that it really means European monolithic control. So that we have been very defensive, trying to prove that we are monotheists. We're ashamed of our people who they call polytheists. We don't even know what those things mean, but we're ashamed of it. Instead of trying to interpret these terms in terms of their posture towards us, which was colonialists. So that if we look at the upper left-hand corner, you see that this religious statement is patriarchal. In it, nature is identified with sin and evil. Nature is that which it should be controlled. It is rationalistic. Remember what we said about that. So it is actually the denial of spirit. It's not a spiritual statement. We have made the mistake of identifying or thinking that you can identify religion with spirituality and they're not the same thing. It is a statement which really deals with fear of blackness. That is, it teaches us to be afraid of blackness as opposed to the concept with which Dr. Richard King would talk about in terms of the black dot being a doorway to deeper spiritual consciousness. In this statement, this religious statement, whiteness is defined as good. Now, these statements, one of the things that I attempt to avoid is making statements which are merely rhetorical. Everything that I say, I not only believe, but to me it makes sense, and I'm trying to make sense of it. So when I say that the religious statement makes people hate blackness, fear blackness, and see whiteness as good, I mean it. I have seen proof of it. There are statements that you can read by African people on the continent, for instance, who have gone through a process of missionary education, who can attest to this in a very personal way. Kofi Awonor, who is an Ewe poet, talks about that in a book called Breast of the Earth. Chinwe Izu talks about that in The West and the Rest of Us. There are many statements which people can talk now about what that whole process did to them. But I have just returned from Ghana. And in Accra, throughout the city, are billboards, and I mean billboards, huge, big posters with a Jesus figure, it's supposed to be, that has blonde, straggly hair and and blue eyes. This is in a black country. And people can look at this and want to move towards it, want to incorporate it into their consciousness. What does that say about the process that was done to enslave our minds? What does that say about the state of self-hatred? Women commonly, this not exceptionally, commonly in Ghana, I understand also in Nigeria, also in Senegal, seen it in Senegal, put chemicals on their skin, which changes the color to something that looks very, very sick. It's like an orangish, unreal kind of tone, which is it's death. They're killing themselves. The process, besides making them lighter, artificially lighter, thins the skin, because what you're really doing is taking the melanin out of your skin. And so, in terms of surgery, if you should ever need it, it can't be performed because the skin can't take sutures. So that when I talk about what this process has done and what it means and what it implies, you see, for our self-concept, I'm not exaggerating when I say these things. When I talk about the proselytization or the missionizing, you see, which is really bringing in a culture and imposing a culture, there are probably, I'm sure that there are more missionaries right now today in Ghana than there were in the, 1500s. More. Churches are everywhere. All different kinds of churches. Yet it is very difficult to find a temple, a shrine, in which you could study, participate, learn about the traditional ancestral spiritual concepts in that country. That's the reality today. You understand? So then if we go to the lower left-hand corner, we will see that what this institution did was to allow the European to identify who they were and who the other was, who the enemy was. How did it do that? Very simply, they were the Christians. Everybody else was the heathen. The heathen is he and she who can be exploited, can be dominated, and can be destroyed. And so you have a pope who says, go throughout the world and reduce all infidels to servitude. And that has been the role of the Christian church in terms of the European Asili, and we've got to understand it. Let's move then to another area. Let's see how this expresses itself through their concepts of beauty, through their concepts of art. Art for them becomes the perfection that does not exist in nature. For African people, we are using artistic expression to make connections, to express our connectedness to a sacred realm. Indeed, to express the sacredness which is within us. For Europeans, nature represents disorder. Therefore, you must create that which is perfection, which is non-spiritual. It is external. We can see what it does affectively, that is in terms of feeling, emotion, motivation. We can see on the other side, cognitively, in terms of thought, what happens. But very importantly for us is how it functions, this aesthetic, how it functions politically. See if I can read that for people who cannot see the board. The European aesthetic causes self-hatred in non-European people, in African people. It causes our inferiorization. That is, it makes us objects. It makes us regard ourselves as objects. It is the rejection of non-European being. Now, what I like to do is to give some examples of this. We've already seen some, I just talked about some, that are very tragic, very sad. Help us to understand that we are at war without knowing we're at war, which is a very bad state to be in. But I want to give you one example that I really I like to give because it brings it right home. The sisters among us who are not real young may have had the experience of going to ballet classes when they were young. How many people here had to go to ballet when you were young? Put your hands up high. Thank you very much. Okay, you will be able to identify and understand this. So we're going to share this with the brothers and with those sisters fortunate enough not to have had to have that experience. You stand in the studio, and the teacher comes around as you are standing next to these bars that they have. So somebody from the community, tell me, what is it that the teacher does? Yes. The teacher comes to you and pushes you in. Literally is pushing your behind in. Why? She says it's too big. Too big for what? There is supposed to be this ideal form that is right for doing that form of dance. We, as African women, are not built correctly to do this form of dance. So these, usually it's little girls when you're doing this. You're usually young. So you're having this experience of somebody telling you that you're not built right. And then you try to walk around, you know, with this pushing your behind in. Well, you can't change that. So that puts you in this state of conflict with yourself. Denial, hatred of yourself. Why am I made like this? Why do you go to ballet? What do they call it? They call it classical. What does classical mean? It means that it is universal. It means that it is the highest form of dance. How did ballet come to be the highest form of dance? Created in Russia long, long, long centuries and centuries. I can't even talk about how much longer it was originated after the original people in Africa and our dance. Think about it. You're talking about a form that was created in, say, the 1500s. You know
know how long we had been dancing by the 1500s? Yet this form is called classical, universal, the highest, the best. And they will say that you should study it before you study other forms of dance. Why? Because it will teach you the proper way. It will teach you technique, discipline, right? If you want to study African dance, well, before, it's probably changed now, but it wouldn't have African dance on the board. You know what it would have? Ethnic. You know what ethnic means? That means it was cultural. One is classical, one is ethnic. What is that saying? They are universal, we are the particular. They are better, we are lesser than. And we incorporate all of these ideas. Okay? I have seen commercials on BET. Starts with an R, I think. I can't remember. What is it? Yeah, that's it. And it's a hair something, to do something to the hair. And they'll have two images, and one in the top of the screen, looking mean and everything, is somebody with their hair just coming out. It's not just in a natural state, but it's not, there's no style whatsoever. Okay, it's not even locked. It's not in a fro. It's just looking crazy. And then they have another image of this person smiling with the slick hair. And you see how those aesthetic concepts are used to control our minds so that we are prepared to be political victims of European world domination. So you see how the aesthetic then is an expression of the Asili. What is the Asili about? European power over non-Europeans. European power over Africans. You see how everything works for that purpose. Everything. Let's go to the next slide. And here we see how important is this concept of self-image. And what happens so that the world can be prepared for their power, so that the definitions can be set up in such a way as to facilitate their power over others. You see that their self-image, to be positive for them, must be dialectically related to a negative image of the other, of the African. So that for them to be superior, we must be inferior. For them to be positive, we must be negative. They are subject acting on, we become the object, that which is controlled. So they know who is we, who is their ego. We are they. We are the other. So that relationship is extremely important. And what happens through this self-image is that as we internalize that definition, you see, we internalize a definition of them as superior, an image of them as superior, then it enables them, it enables the European, who is a minority of the world, a small minority of the world, less than 10%. And getting smaller, it enables them to
gain the illusion of power over everybody else, while at the same time as we internalize these images, it prevents us, the majority, you see, from realizing our source of power, which is the very part of us which we are learning to hate, the very part of us which we are rejecting, which we are denying. Makes sense for them to deny it, because they don't have it. Can't control it. But for us to deny it, we're denying our source of power. So this process of creating these images is very important. I understood it in terms of the discipline of anthropology, for instance, which is very key in supporting the European self-image as superior, the image of Africans as inferior, that whole civilized, primitive dichotomy. That was why anthropology was created, to support that process of self-definition for the European, and to put forth an image of Africans that would support and justify the colonial relationship, that we were not capable of governing and ruling ourselves. Next slide, please. And here, and by the way, for those of you who are reading the book, who have read the book, we're now at chapter 6, 7, and 8. Again, the Asili lacks spirit, seeks power. And here we're talking about European behavior and ethics in racial and cultural domination. By ethics, we simply mean the rules that they use to govern their behavior. We do not mean that they are moral in our sense, or that we should expect them to be, and, or that that should be our objective, because it's not about morality when we're dealing with a non-Ma'otic people. If we look at the left side of the diagram in the triangle, it is talking about the behavior of Europeans towards Europeans, okay, within the culture, so to speak. And we see that the behavior is competitive, it is individualistic, it is compulsively controlled. That is lacking a trust of feeling. And it is aggressive. There is no spiritual community within European culture, within European society. There is no spiritual joining. Now, it is aggressive, and there is a danger there, because if the aggression goes unlimited, what will they do? They will self-destruct. They will destroy each other. It's very important, so it will break down the system. All right? If we look at the large triangle on the right, here you will see that because of this reality, that they would destroy themselves, they create a construct, a concept of the cultural other. Who is the cultural other? The cultural other is us. The cultural other is the object. The object which was created by Plato in terms of the Academy and rationalist thought. The object, you're set up already. What is the object? The object is that being, again, who it is okay to be aggressive towards. How aggressive? Unlimited. The cultural other is that group, that race, that it's okay to do whatever it is they need to do for their purposes. There are no holes barred when it comes to the cultural other. You might be limited when it comes to dealing with another European, but when you're dealing with the cultural other, when you're dealing with an African, it's okay to do anything you need to do. That's the way their ethic works. We need to understand that. We have never understood that. We have approached them as though they thought like we thought, as though they functioned like we functioned, so that the behavior of the Europeans towards others, towards the cultural other, can be violent to any degree, and is. And we are witnessing that. It is xenophobic. Diop has told you that. Meaning a fear and a hatred of strangers, of anybody who is different from they, because they know what that means. And then Dr. Welsing tells us even more so why. Because of the threat, because of their own survival, because they are this tiny minority of the world. The cultural other can be exploited to any degree, can be destroyed, should be dominated. And so their behavior towards others is genocidal. And we need to understand that. We're still thinking like, oh, they wouldn't do that. Instead of interpreting everything that they do in terms of their asili. And what is the nature of their asili? It's for ultimate control, world domination, European power over other. Now, what happens to us? We don't use that analysis to interpret their words. And so they cleverly, that evil genius, they have constructed what they call, no, not what they call, what I call, the rhetorical ethic. They would never call it that. What is the rhetorical ethic? It is a statement which is created just for us, just for the victims of their aggressive, exploitative, destructive behavior. It is a statement which does not reflect their intent. It is a statement which disarms us. Why? Because we listen to the words of so-called brotherly love, and we act on them as though it was the truth of what Europeans really are about. And that is the role of the missionary. The missionary who softens us up, you see, and breaks our will. Because on the one hand, they come in talking about love, and at the same time, on the other hand, they are tearing down our culture and the very thing that would give us the strength to resist. That's what the missionary does, and that's what the rhetorical ethic does, and that's what happens in the academy. That's what happens with the so-called liberals. I would include in that any of them, even the so-called progressives, the Marxists, any of them. The language is, we're here to help you. The reality is, we are expressing the European A silly, which means that we're here to control you. And that goes for all of them. So that the indigenous people here were quite correct. White man really does speak with forked tongue. Next slide, please. For those of you who are in the back, I don't know if you can see the slides. This is the ideology of European world domination, chapters 7 and 8. I'm sorry, 9 and 10. And this is how all of this works itself out in ideological statements, statements that we have not been able to recognize as ideology. But now that we have the Asili analysis, we will be able to do that. Let's look first at thought, the utamawazo. And here they become very tricky. And many of us right now are caught up in this. I call it the syntax of universalism, the language of universalism. When we begin getting to the core, the heart of this attack on our people, and talking about where we need to go in order to pull out and pull from the strength from our ancestral wisdom. When we talk about, like Marcus Mosiah Garvey did, in terms of race first, what do? They talk about universalism. Suddenly they become the universalists. Multiculturalism, perfect. You see how the terminology begins to be turned around. And then we find ourselves using their terminology. That is to keep us from being African-centered. So they talk about multiculturalism suddenly. These people who hate and fear difference, they talk about multiculturalism. But it's very tricky. You see, because we want to be the universalists, the humanitarians, and we will say, I'm just human, and we're all human. And that is to do away with difference. The best of them, that you think is the best of them, will talk to you about one culture, about doing away with difference. And you know what that means in their terms, and translated, interpreted in terms of their Asili? It means European world domination. That's what it means. Universalism translates into the ideological doctrine of European superiority, which is another way of saying white supremacism. It is imperialistic, absolutistic, and monolithic. Just when we, like we were talking about that concept of monotheism, interpreted in terms of the Asili. So what we need to do is, no matter what they say, whatever language they use, always look at it in terms of the Asili. How does it work to fulfill the Asili? And then we will understand, no, we don't want to be universal, we want to be African. Right. If other people can deal with that, can relate to that, if that can help them, fine. But our purpose has got to be to avenge the spirits of our ancestors. If we look over at the utamarojo, the energy, the affective energy of the culture, and then we understand that in the middle always is the Asili that is seeking energy by imposing its own disorder on the world through racial and cultural domination, we see that the utamarojo has expressed itself ideologically through this idea of progressivism or of progress. And it has tricked us again, because we sit here even now, as I speak, And I know you all want to make progress. You want to be progressive. Yet ask yourself, what is your model of progress? What does it look like? Does it look like the European? Well, this idea of progress was used to justify every act of aggression, every colonial enterprise that the European undertook. The 19th century British Empire, people could talk proudly of the fact that the sun never set on their empire. Proud they were of this. They could say this as if this was a good thing. The British went around the world colonizing African people and other non-European people. The British Museum right now in London is a testament to that. They have a wing that's Chinese, a wing that's Indian, a couple of wings that are African. Right here, huh? They have all of these things which are not theirs, which they've stolen, which to them say, we were great. This was our imperial might. Now, how was that rationalized? It was rationalized because they were bringing progress to the world. That's what they said. And progress meant them. It meant we are making people want to be what we are, making people want to have what we have. It's a form of cultural enslavement, mental enslavement. It is something that disconnects you from your spirit. And right now, today, on the continent, that is the battle that we are fighting. As we sit here, right now, us, as we sit here with the drum, feeling our Africanness, affirming that and seeking to recover it through the principle of Sankofa. As we sit here and do that, our brothers and sisters on the continent are trying as hard as they can to become European. They are doing that because they see Europe as representing civilization and the pinnacle of morality, of intelligence, of everything that is good. And they can do that because of this concept of progress, which said that everything was moving towards something. Nobody knew what it was, but it was moving towards something in this line, and that it was the Europeans that were taking it there. And you need to study the philosophical statements, the development even of the discipline of the social sciences, sociology, and how they were statements of this whole view so that they could be sold to the rest of the world. That there was this process that everybody, it was this universal process that everybody in the world was going through, moving towards becoming civilized, becoming more progressive. And that process was called progress, and it was the Europeans who were in control of the process. That kind of thinking, that ideology, is still functioning now. And it has got our brothers and sisters on the continent moving away from themselves. So it becomes our job, indeed, to convince them that they are the source, that they are in touch with it. We have to do that. We have to retrieve it. We have to study it. We have to know it. And then we have to teach it. And I was convinced of that even more so when I was there recently. finally, then, let's look at the next slide, which is an overall statement, a kind of summary of how this all works. You begin at the bottom with the Asili. The Asili is pathological. It is not natural, it is pathological. It manifests itself in the Utamawazo and the Utamarojo. The Asili reorders the universe through the thought process, the Utamawazo, and is then justified or reinforced by the energy, the Utamarojo. The Utamawazo, the cognitive manifestation of the Asili, the Utamarojo, the affective energy of the Asili. They are mutually supportive. They are the Asili. Don't think of them as separate. They then give birth to these various forms and institutions in the society. So you have institutionalized religion or Christianism, which is anti-nature. It tells you that your natural self is to be overcome. Think about it. It tells you that you were born in sin. That's a very deep concept. The African concept is that you are born divine. Every African child is sacred because they were born in this sacred universe by the Creator. And each and every one of us becomes an expression of that divine creative principle. That's the African conception. But in this conception, you are always trying to overcome and deny that which is natural in you. And you are always trying to apologize for the fact that you were born. I was in the marketplace in Accra. Christianity is very, very heavy in Ghana. And I came to one of the stalls, which had books. It had a lot of Christian books. And I asked the sister about them. I just wanted to get into a discussion with her. She said she was Christian. And I said, what does that mean? She, you know, didn't know how to answer that. I said, why are you a Christian? And after I finally got her to see that that was a question, that was a valid question, she said, now, you know, I don't want to step on anybody's toes. I'm going to tell you exactly what she said. I'm just doing this to be accurate. She said, I have learned to accept Jesus, who will help me because I am as a filthy rag. Those were her words, which shows you what it was that whatever religion it was that she thought she had, that's what it was doing to her mind. Now, just put that in cultural terms. You will understand the function of that institution within Europe. In terms of ideology and values, you can see materialism, white supremacy, the denial of spirit or the devaluation of spirit, money becomes a symbol of value. The aesthetic is artificial, non-spiritual, white. The self-image is as controlling nature, being threatened by nature. So you have to control it as superior, rational, white. The image of others is as inferior. They are natural, which is bad. We are natural, which is bad, as object, irrational, and black.
The other is black. The intracultural behavior, there is no concept of a cosmic self. So you have the isolated individual ego, which fights other isolated individual egos. And here we, as African people, a spiritual people, adopt this concept of individualism and wonder why we're going crazy. Wonder why there's violence in our communities. And so behavior towards others is non-human, is genocidal and imperialistic. All of this reinforces the Asili, an Asili which, lacking in spirit, seeks power to fill the void. And this we have called the tangle of European cultural pathology, which creates the system of European world domination, a system of death without rebirth, based on destruction. The question becomes, if they destroy themselves, what will happen to us in the process? That is a question that we have to address. An important prior question. This system has power. Where does it get its power from? Let's look at the next slide. Let's begin again with the Asili at the top and then move towards the right. The Asili needs power, so it creates an utamawazo, which is the way Europeans are taught to think. It defines the universe for the use of European power over other. They then create the system or the process of objectification. And they do that by denying spirit and degrading nature. Institutions which are based on that utamawazo, that concept of thought, of truth. And in those institutions, we are taught, that is, African people are taught, the rest of us are taught to think according to their rules. And so we become educated in their truth. And the result is that African people then define themselves, we define ourselves as inferior objects of European domination, as we are trained to accept the system of global white supremacy as truth. Let's look again at the top, at the Asili, which is the origin. It needs power. You move to the left, so it seeks to fulfill itself. And then we have the Platonic discovery of how you could use a concept of truth and make it an ideology by saying it's the only way to know, the only way to approach reality. A concept which looks like them. And so he established the academy based on the concept and process of objectification, based on a tyranny of rationalism or control. And what happened in that academy? It was a training ground and continues to be a training ground for those who are supposed to dominate. They are taught to dominate. At the same time, those who are to be dominated are taught to be dominated. They are taught to be ruled. We are taught to be victims, to be objects. That is the method as we are taken away from our source and taught to deny our spirit.
And so this results in Africans learning to think of themselves as inferior objects, being trained to accept the system of global white supremacy as truth. We internalize their truth in the academy, in nursery schools, in elementary school, through the TV, wherever. We tell their story for them. This is the process of the colonization of the African mind. It is the process of mental slavery and how that comes to be. You can only be a slave if there is a master. So this is the process by which the master is created and thereby the slave. Question: where does the system get its power from? Who can tell me the answer?
Us.
It gets its power from us. We give up our power. How? As we accept their definition of truth and reality. That's how it works. What do we have to do to break that power?
Redefine.
Come back home. Do Sankofa. The next one. Oh, I have that one up there. All right. What that one is about, you can't see it too clearly, but that is about what happens, you see. I really wanted to do another one first, but let's do that one. Now, suppose we focus on a European. We destroy the European, or the European destroys himself. What happens then? Everything's perfect, huh?
No.
Why? Why isn't it? All right. Good. Very good. Very good, sister. Here's how I see it. I see Yurugu as a virus. A virus that has infected us. We became host for that virus. Once the virus infects us, then we exhibit behaviors which are anti-African. We begin treating each other not as Africans should treat each other. We are a people in self-denial, self-conflict. We are treating ourselves as objects, taking drugs, eating poorly. We are treating each other as objects, killing each other. We are involved in relationships which are controlling, which are exploitative. We have forgotten the sacred mother principle. So we are out of balance. We have taken on patriarchal forms. We deny the spiritual. We have no time for the spiritual. We do not incorporate the spiritual in our organizations. Our organizations are hierarchical. They are about ego. Leadership is about ego. Leadership is not accountable. There is no system of accountability. We believe only in an academic concept of truth and think that our children's learning takes place in school. So our children are taken away from us. So our children can be good at math and then totally irresponsible. And we think that's being smart. We do all of these things because the virus is in us. So what does that mean that we have to do? We have to cleanse ourselves. We have to heal. We have to come. come back to our concepts of truth. Let's have the next slide, I think. Everybody else was ignorant. We go into the academy in a state of self-denial and come out of it how? Prepared to destroy African people. For instance, there's a crime bill. We identify, oh great, they're gonna take all those awful people off the street. Not understanding that these are our children. This is our future. And that's because of who we've been taught to identify with. We come out of these institutions ready to support and perpetuate European domination. We come out denying an African worldview. And we come out, most importantly, afraid of African ritual. Ritual. Ritual is the deepest kind of learning that we can have. Ritual is spiritual learning. It is through ritual that we internalize truth. But we've been taught to be afraid of African ritual. And so the effect that our sojourn through these institutions, various institutions, whether it's the academy, the church, whatever it is to turn us against ourselves and to have us denying our ancestors. The system indeed gets its power through us, from us. And all we have to do is to deny it that source of power. And the way to do that is for us to return to the source, is for us to create our own institutions. The brother got up and talked about starting a business. We have been taught to be dependent. The Maafa is that great disaster. When we were raped, kidnapped, and made political prisoners, which we still are. And in the process of the Maafa, which continues, we were trained to be dependent on the very being that would destroy us. That's the process of enslavement. That is the creation of the master. So that we cannot visualize an independent African institution. We have all the resources that we need, but we don't build our own schools, our own universities, whatever we would call them. We're in a state of denial. That's the answer. We've got to get back that kind of belief in self. Can I have the next slide, please? And there are people who are doing that, African people who are bringing back the power of Africa, which is the power to do, the power to energize, reconnecting to the source in our own environments. Next slide, please. We are doing them by creating our own places of study with our own objectives and goals in environments which feed us and nurture our spirits. These are people who are involved in a leadership training process in Virginia that is run by a group called Ankabia that comes out of Washington, D.C. The brother Ajay Okoto has written a book called Nation Building, which every African people person should read. And that is about creating our own environments based on our own concepts, which affirm who we are, which allow us to use our own resources for ourselves, our own energies for ourselves. Next slide, please. And in these environments, We not only think together, discuss together, but we actually build together. How many people here have actually participated in the act of building a building? Not very many. And if you have, sister, that's good. All of us need to be able to do that, to build together. These young people are building a building. Next slide, please. And so we participate with the symbols that connect us to our source, the sacred stools, and we honor our sacred ancestors, and we use their energy to continue to build. And our young people, as you see the sister there, grows up in this. Imagine how affirming that is for her. Next slide. And we wear clothing that is actually made by us. You see a camp here, Heritage Village Encampment, where young people make their own clothing, do their own dances, dance to their own rhythm, to the rhythm of their people. If you grow up in that, you have a very different concept than most of us have now. You don't want to put chemicals on your skin, or your hair for that matter. You don't want to imitate another person's way of thinking. You glorify what is your own, and you feel the strength of that. Next slide, please. We see here, well, I guess people in the back can't see, but even the waist beads that have been made, they're beautiful beaded jewelry that is around the waists of the sisters who are dancing. It's made by them. In that environment, which is theirs, on land, that is owned by their family, which is our family. That's nation building. So it's a way of thinking that will help us to cleanse. Because we are talking, as Aikwe Arma told us, about not the healing of a single person, but we're talking about the healing of a race. And the healing of African people will take place through the act and the activity of nation building, which is the building and the creation of African institutions. Up, you mighty race. You can accomplish what you will. Madasi, Madasi. Sadasi.
Change and then go to the.
You want to leave at 9:15?
I want to start getting ready.
I want to read this here.
Okay,
we're going to have a brief question and answer period. Before we start that, we're going to have a poem presentation by Brother Richard White. Once again, give her another hand for this.
Amos, the battle must be joined. No nation, no civilization have come to the fore without new organization, without thinking new thoughts, without working, without actually doing, without being willing to take a chance, a willingness to risk all, without a willingness to go against overwhelming odds, without a determination to be the best, to be superior, without a desire to determine its destiny and that of others, without a willingness to fight, to shed blood, to risk defeat, the battle must be joined. It must be fought, being a battle of mind, mind wars of spirit, of will, of belts of iron and steel, shell and bomb, of tank and plane, of rockets and satellite, star wars of technology, of information. the battle must be fought. The gauntlet throw down, the chip now knocked from the belt, bully's shoulder, the line stepped over, the clash and clang of sword, curses of men, mounds of pain. The battle must be joined. Fought in the streets from door to door, in the schoolroom, in the boardroom, in the bedroom, in the war room, hand-to-hand combat must commence. The battle must ultimately be won in the field. It matters not if you're erratically delineated the subtleties and the nuances of racism and racial discrimination. If you can delicately dissect with a master surgeon skill the anatomy of race and the body of politics. If you can tease out the intense thread. If you can paint the most beautiful dreams on canvas or write the greatest vision of parchment. Or ride in your time machine and visit ancient African kingdoms, cities, and empires, or feel the pain and degradation of slavery, or celebrate all we have given to the world, or point out with great explanation the white devil. Still, the challenge must be taken up. Fire must fight fire. Institution, traditions, habits, hopes must be uprooted, raised, and put to the torch. No stone left unturned, and institutions, traditions, habits, hopes must be restored, rekindled, or rebuilt anew. Bricks stacked in place, new songs must be sung, new voices must carry the tune, new feet must march to the new drum beats, new hands, new banners, and standard raised. These songs must be your songs, the voices, your voices, the feet, your feet. The hands must be the ones at the end of your arms. The soul unsold to the devil must be your soul. A new world must be created. Make it your world, a mandala.
That there will be a raffle, but that will be conducted after the question and answer period. Very quickly, I would like to read an announcement for our next program. The Philadelphia Study Group of ASCAP, the Association for the Study of Classical African Civilization, will host an open house for the purpose of forming more African-centered study groups. February 18th, 1995, from 4:30 p.m. to 5:30 p.m. here at the International House. If you need additional information, you may call 549-8248 or 549-6108. I repeat, 549-8248 or 549-6108. There are a number of other announcements of other African organizations that have a number of programs coming up in the next few months. I don't have time to read them all right now, but I strongly urge you to pick up a copy of your flyers, which are on the tables outside there. Now, you've had a very meaty meal here. Hotep? Let me urge you to continue this process to recapture your African mind, to understand your oppressor, and to get on the road of liberation. By taking a look and purchasing some of the books we have on the outside on the table there. Many classic works are there, including some of the good sister here. Not only was Yurugu a classic work, but there's a little tiny volume there called Let the Circle Be Unbroken. Now, there's a book, it's really tiny, but it is compact with incredible information about African spirituality. A word that seems to be very confusing out there because Europeans are talking about spirituality. They damn sure are not talking about what we're talking about. And indeed, you know, if we're on the right track of recovering our minds, we need to know what African spirituality is about to incorporate in all aspects of our struggle and our lifestyle. It is, in fact, one of the factors, one of the traits that we will be looking for in each other, and looking for in our institutions as to whether or not you're on track. Brothers and sisters, let's welcome the good sister back to the microphone for a brief question and answer period. Now, this will only be for 15 minutes. Your question and answer. If you can, please come to the front because we don't have any microphones there, and speak loudly and clearly so that the entire audience can understand what you're saying. Thank you.
There's a brother, he wanted his book signed. Going back, don't go anywhere. I'll do it as soon as the questions come. Okay? You want to recognize people?
One, two, three.
I just want to say thank you very much for being here and
thank you.
Bringing us this business. Would you just tell me what you meant by Jerry So, Benny So, Olo So? And I just want to make a comment when you were speaking of the, that they will self-destruct and break down the system. And I just wanted to bring it to the fore. One of the things they approved the NAFTA, a trade agreements, and within just a relatively short period of time, they are ready now to give a $40 billion loan. So that's part of their own self-aggression and their own ways that they are beginning to self-destruct. So what will happen to us? It's up to us to build our own systems, our own schools, et cetera, et cetera.
Right. Those terms come from the Dogon system, of the process of knowledge. And I said, Jerry So, they've translated as word at face value. Benny So, word from the side. Bolo So, word from behind. And So Dai, the clear word. That's the translation.
That's in the book. Some further discussion on it?
No. No. I do that other places, and I've done that in lectures, because I interpret them. You can try yourself to then interpret what each would mean. I have a chart I could show you later that elaborates on them.
Okay,
what I've been doing is doing, I just started doing workshops on the book, and that's one of the things that I include in the workshop. So if people are interested in that, that's something you can organize and then, you know, contact me to come in.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, sure. All right. Mm-hmm.
Can the people who have questions move to the center and then that way, or stand up at least so that we can hear you, then we'll move you in order. We'll start here and go back. Everybody's okay.
Yeah, question.
Yeah.
Everyone else with questions, please come to the center here so we can have it organized.
We won't be able to go on too long because I also want to leave time for people to sign people's books. I know people want that. And then I have to leave. I have to catch a train.
Go ahead. Who says what's natural and or what's African? How is that determined? How do they know?
Okay.
What authority?
It certainly is not an authority in the sense of a hierarchy. It's part of a process of us retrieving, studying, and looking for, I'll tell you what I've done, looking for the common principles that are found in the various expressions of African culture, African institutions, and African spiritual systems. Because one of the things that you find is that while there are different languages and the spiritual entities, for instance, will be given different names, you find the common principles in all African spiritual systems, the ancestors, the universe as a spiritual whole, the things that I was talking about, they're all there in all African systems, in all of the culture. Now, there certainly are the instances of the denial of those things, which are, you know, atypical behavior, which always makes for our destruction. For instance, the selling of other Africans, or even the enslavement of other Africans. And we need to see that as anti-African behavior, you know, African anti-African behavior.
I'm referring to the phenomena of I'm more African than you are.
You know what I believe? I don't even use the term African-American, for instance. To me, that's a contradiction in terms. And I see it as the Asili manifest itself in us. There is a saying which a brother very close to me was the first to say it to me. Then it's been said, I think, in the book recently, Chester Higgins' book, but that Africa is born in me. And so we ourselves become manifestations of that Asili. What happens is that that African Asili manifests itself in different ways, but the core, the seed, is always consistent, is always there. Just like the Europeans is always consistent, ours is always consistent too, but it takes different forms. So that we are all in, we as African people are all living in a state of contradiction. All of us. We are all in a transitional process. All of us. So that I never want to stand up and sound like I'm being judgmental about what some African people are doing as though I myself, you know, are at a different place. I am at a different place, but I'm not at the same place as somebody else is at. You know, this work that we all are involved in a process together. So that doesn't make any sense. And I think even the brothers and sisters on the continent are, I just came back from PANAFEST, which was a conference over there. And there was this feeling of the recognition of the special place that we have as diasporic Africans, Africans, you know, born here. In the whole movement to reclaim African civilization, as opposed to that view of, well, they're the real Africans, you know, and we aren't. So, you know, your question is a good one, but it is, it's not like there's any easy answer. It's that the answer is in the process itself, and the process is that return to self that we all have to be involved in.
Your response.
Okay.
Thank you.
In one of the temples over in Egypt, in one of the temples of Egypt, there is a expression, man, know thyself.
Right.
Know thyself.
Mm-hmm.
So most of the improvement will have to come from us ourselves.
Right. Absolutely. The comment was the inscription on the temple in Kemet, know thyself, that comes from us. And what is meant by that is that we are a microcosm of the universe, that the principles of the universe exist in us. So that in studying ourselves and knowing ourselves, we come to know the universe. And the same is true as we study the universe, we are coming to know ourselves. And that's what that's about. It's about the connectedness again.
We have only time for maybe two more questions. It's 9:10.
I want to make a comment as well as a question. You mentioned about nation building.
Yes.
Okay, I'm in agreement with that.
Yes.
I think a lot of us agree with that too.
Yes.
But I also believe that it takes a great deal of money to establish programs and projects that would benefit us.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
mm-hmm.
I also believe that we have a number of African Americans who do have the means to do that,
mm-hmm.
but they may be afraid to
mm-hmm.
because now I'm going to ask a question. How do we do that without becoming, how about that, interfered or developing a paranoia or by the establishment?
Okay.
And, at the moment we do that, we become sabotaged.
Okay. The question is, how do we build independent African institutions without being destroyed or without having agents among us or whatever? The pictures that I showed you, the slides, were of an institution that has been in existence for over 20 years and is growing and expanding. Numerically still it's small, but it's in process. It has grown, and it has done that without grants from the government, being independent. It has done that. This is Watoto School in Washington. I don't know if people know it, Nation House Positive Action Center, and that's one example that I know because I've worked very closely with them. The answer is that we have to focus on building. Don't focus on what the enemy can do. Focus on what we can do. When you talked about it taking a lot of money, one of the things that Brother Amos used to tell us all the time, you take a community like Harlem and people think of it as a poor community. Yet, there are economic resources in Harlem. The amount of money that African people spend yearly in this country alone is unbelievable if you have the figures. We are talking in the hundreds of billions. You hear what I'm saying? I'm not exaggerating, and you can get the figures. I have some in the book, but they need to be updated. We have that, and we don't spend it with a nationalist consciousness. We spend it as individuals. So it's not that we don't have the resources to do what we have to do. And that if we, it's the consciousness that we don't have. Once we have the consciousness, we'll use our resources correctly, and we will deal with whatever we have to deal with as it comes. Paranoia, we cannot allow paranoia, as you're calling it, and you know, the word is good, to stop us from work. Do you see what I'm saying? If we did that we would stay in a kind of we would be functioning out of fear. We can't do that. That is not to say that it is not a reality of what has been done in the past, COINTELPRO and so forth. I'm not saying that, you talk about everything that you're doing. You pick your forums. You know what you know, if you're serious, then you don't have to do a lot of talking about it, that kind of thing. But the most important thing is that you know what it is that you want to do and that you get people together who want to do the same thing, and it'll come to be.
Thank you.
Brothers and sisters, I'm afraid.
Wait, let's.
You want to take one more?
Yeah, and then the sister.
Okay. I was originally in Zion as well.
Oh, okay.
And one of the discussions we had was about the tension between brothers and sisters here and brothers and sisters on the continent, and that in order for us to come together, particularly around the whole issue of some of us having been a part of the so-called slave trade, that we have to overcome that. We have to develop some kind of healing process.
Right.
So would you speak to that?
Sure, I will. As a part of PANAFEST that I just came back from, I think it was 2 days before I actually arrived in Ghana, there was a ceremony which was the first of its kind, as I understand, and Gary Bird, who is in New York, was there, was a part of it, and has been talking about it on the radio. He is a talk person that we all know in New York, where the traditional leaders, the Oman Hanis, came together, organized a ceremony where they actually made a statement of the sorrow that they felt because of what had happened during this period, which was a first on that level for that to happen. So it's like the beginning of a healing process. What I was struck by through the conference of PANIFEST was that there is a new awareness of ancient African civilization for continental Africans. That is, they are now talking about civilization as we know it, what we created, what we did in terms of science, math, and so forth, which is very new for them, but means that they got to take their lead from us. Because it's over here that that kind of information is coming forth. I mean, you have Diop, but you have Diop really being studied here. so that what I was seeing was that the beginning of that healing process is beginning to take, it's taking place. Haile Gerima was there. He was given a very important role. So he addressed the entire body. Whereas others of us were in, you know, in smaller groups. And he talked about, in fact, it brings tears to your eyes when he talks, because what he said was that it is Africans in the diaspora who brought him back to his source, who, because of our special kind of experience, had made him feel who he was in a way that he hadn't before. And he said that particularly there was a focus on the dungeons, which, by the way, we will never call castles again. So change your vocabulary on that. But the dungeons where we were kept, which you see in the film Sankofa. How many people have seen Sankofa? Excellent. Okay, that's a good basis. So I'm talking about the brother who made the film. But he says, he was telling the brothers and sisters on the continent that they have to listen to us in terms of the significance of those dungeons, because we bring to them an experience which they could never know. Right. And just in hearing him talk about that, he also talked about this deep love that we have for Africa in spite of rejection, in spite of all the things that we have gone through. We continue to have this relationship. We won't be turned back in terms of having to reclaim Africa. And so that we have to teach the African world. So I agree with you that it is necessary, the process, but I also feel, what I came away feeling, was that the process is at least recognized that it has to happen. So, and that's a beginning. That's a beginning. Yes, last question.
Hi. I attend a predominantly white school. Mm-hmm. And my question was, I'm trying to adopt your ideas. Mm-hmm. So when this white person that's going through their vibe, their essence, they're dressing like me, whatever, comes up to me and says, you know, mm-hmm. How can I be black?
Right.
I say, you know, first, you know, you gotta deny your little selfish values, and you know, you have to get a little I don't know what they call it, but you know, soul, and your European asili. I don't know what to call them after that. You know?
Okay. The question is, when this European comes to her and says, "How can I be black?" What does she say? The answer is, you never ever try to tell them how to do that, ever. Okay, that posture towards you is a posture of superiority. It's a posture which is self-serving for European people. It's a posture which perpetuates European power. If that person is talking about his or her political intent, if they really want to do good, then they need to leave you alone. They need to go back to their people and deal with the work that their people have to do among themselves. And I'm not saying, by the way, that I'm not talking about hope for them. because I'm not the least bit interested in what can happen with them. Because as far as I'm concerned, that a Sealy is what it is and it cannot be changed. But what I'm saying is I'm looking at, you have to understand, why is this person talking to you? Why would somebody say to you, how can I be black? Do you understand? That's a denial of what it is that they are. And that's what they're trying to get you to do. The thing that happens, because I went to a white school too, what they try to do is to come at you as an individual and try to get you to regard them as an individual, you see. And for you to do that, if you start thinking, oh, well, this is a good one, then what you're doing is you're not thinking politically anymore, and they have disarmed you. Always think in terms of the Asili. It is consistent. It goes for all of them. What you need to do is to focus on your people. You're in a bad place, which is a white school. Many of us are. So you go there very focused on what it is that you want to get out of there, and you get out of there. And then you start, you come back home. Okay? Thank you.
Let me apologize for my ignorance.
The carousel?
And my,
yeah, I need it.
Sinfulness.
That these were taken out.
Because my wife
has
been excellent and really helping us carry the rhythm. And so could we all give her a hand?
Yes, please. I need to see it. I want to see it, actually. Yes, and I want to give a special madasi, Sante Sana, to the brother. The drum is always the most important thing that we can have, and it always helps me. And I meant to do that, and I thank you so much. Thank you, brother.
It's clear to me that you all have enthusiastically received this lecture tonight. If you're interested in additional workshops, would you raise your hands, please, so we can get a sense of that interest?
What, for the signing?
No, additional workshops on the book.
Oh, okay.
If you're interested in additional workshops on the book, please raise your hand. Thank you very much for your support tonight.